we'll be best start with an apology for me. There was no pre-meeting discussion this evening, and the reason for that was that there was a funeral from a former elected member of the council, and some people would have wanted to attend that. I wasn't sure who would want to attend, you know, but that was the reason for the not having a briefing beforehand. But what we did is you get out of it. Right, well, we start with the usual first item, which is the declarations of interest. Are there any declarations of interest? Phil?
Yes. In the annual accounts on page 135, there's a reference to the E.F. Haddiscourt Trust, whereas our monitoring officer is the Sebastian.
No.
So that is in the process of changing and being reorganised and possibly taken over by other trustees, but members of the Standards Committee apparently are the trustees currently. And as it mentions, the Haddiscourt Trust, I'd better keep that in interest.
It's not a peculiar Well, before we go to the next item, can I first of all just point out a little bit of a criminal act on my part. I completely forgot to mention that we have some subs this evening. We've got Jerry, I believe, subbing for either Jeff Green or John Hale.
Jeff Green.
Jeff Green, yes, and we've got Adam Sykes.
Has he ever seen
it yet? But when he comes, he'll be. Well, he's not a garrulous sort of chap, so if we, you know, we can get most of the meeting done.
Yes, I can.
And then we also have Anita Holm, Anita Leach's part apology, and Tony, you're standing in for her, aren't you?
Yes, thank you.
I think that covers everyone, doesn't it? And we also have Phil McCourt sitting with us here. And he is the acting, I'm describing him as the acting head of the law. For the, it's effectively a very long round in terms of that. Okay. So, with that then, we can go on to the. You had your hand up.
Yeah, just declarations of interest, because a lot of the tonight's agenda is the pension fund. My wife is a member of the pension fund, and I suffer personally from pension envy.
Okay.
And so, I declare an opportunity because I'm going to be recipient of the Mersey Crescent Pension Fund.
Okay, that's two. We've got that. In that case, then, if you go on to the minutes of the last meeting. I'm sorry, Tony, Heather.
I'm a scheme member as well, the Mersey Crescent
Pension Fund. You're a scheme member as well.
Yeah.
Okay. No. Any other declarations? Then we'll go on to the minutes of the previous meeting. Thank you, you've all read them very closely. And is anybody willing to move that they're accurate records? We move, seconded. All agreed?
Agreed.
Second item relates to payroll, teachers' pensions. This is an issue that colleagues from external lawyers have identified in relation to teachers' pensions payments. We've subsequently undertaken some more detailed work to try and determine the exact nature of the problem to identify what appropriate action is required, including making improvements in the overall control elements to prevent any sort of appearance of this nature. Recommendations have been formulated, have been agreed with senior management, and will ultimately implement a more effective control environment. Further follow-up work is scheduled in this area later in the year to test those controls, and the outcome will be reported to yourselves in due course. Final item that I wanted to bring to your attention, this section relates to the RMC member training. You recall in previous meetings we've talked about organising and delivering specific targeted training for members of this committee. Arrangements, provisional arrangements at this stage have been made with the professionals at the training that we utilised previously, and a date, again, a provisional date, the 22nd of November between 1 and 4 o'clock and 3. All members who have not yet attended this training are encouraged to confirm that they can be in attendance, where perhaps they're not. Social deputies identified and requested.
Is that the training that we've already, I've already been on?
Some of you have attended, yeah. Not too many of you, but you certainly have attended. Attention is also drawn to section 3.3 of the report on page 19, where a table identifies information relating to results where the recommended actions included in our reports remain outstanding in this picture. The actual table is attached to appendix 2. Members will note that all items are complete and both practices, indicating that work is in progress. Entries in respect of sickness absence and data loss prevention have been the subject of further separate reports by individual officers attending this committee and providing you with assurances in relation to actions that have been undertaken. And we will continue to sort of monitor the implementation of the actions. Section 3.4 on page 20 of the report identifies information related to the performance of the internal audit service. You'll note that delivery of the audit plan is approximately on top of this time of year. Members will be aware that we have been carrying a number of vacancies throughout the year. All of those vacancies have been filled. There is just one individual who remains to start. We do it on the 23rd this month. Allow us to effectively catch up that shortfall that's identified in the report. Feedback from clients and management teams remains very good. All key actions identified in all reports have been agreed, and the client satisfaction levels remains consistently high. Section 3.5, page 20 of the report, identifies some of the continuing improvements that have been made in the VID service. This is a regular feature of this report, which is provided merely to demonstrate that ongoing action to sort of challenge and develop the nature of the service in line with involving developing the public sector environment best practice is in place. I would ask that members note the report and take any appropriate actions. I'm more than happy to take any questions that members may have.
Yeah, thank you, Jim. Just very, very quickly, a couple of administrative points, really. Just for the record, the ARMC training thing is going to take place at Birmingham Town Hall, is it not? That's worth noting for people who haven't been before. Yes. And the second thing we discussed in our briefing was perhaps we should not just invite deputies who can't come because a main member can't come, but invite all deputies in the country because they are likely at some stage to have to sit on this committee. It would be worthwhile if they had a chance to attend this course, but if they wish to do so. That's it.
I think we would all be happy rather than just have it.
Sorry,
sir. I'm in the gate. We have an email through the process.
I'm really wanting to run the day by yourselves at this meeting, but you're happy to follow up with any detailed email.
And Phil?
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to go back to absence management, sickness absence, which we've talked about on a number of occasions, and which does appear much later on in the agenda where we get to page 126. In another place, I was talking in detail with staff from CYPD, looking at the breakdown for sickness in that particular area, particularly in connection with children's services. And therefore I've seen data comparing that unit, that sector of work with other parts of council on an overall figure. But it would be helpful, I think, to members, because the report later on talks about the presentation to the leadership team on the 12th of September, which I'm going to take as a like, trigger date for the start of a revised process. It would be helpful if we were able to track just how many managers have got through the relevant number of staff, so we can see a clear progression from now until March. Because after all, we're asking to work through several thousand people over 6 months, but a clear idea of how it is progressing, so it doesn't slip. Our past concerns have always been that we've got to X percentage, and we should have been at Y by a certain time.
Take your point on board. I'll make sure that the development officer is briefed. There are plans for a more detailed report on asset management to be presented to this committee in November, following the discussion at the account meeting. You might recall that when we met, discussed this previously at the last business management committee meeting, it was escalated to account for the discussion and debate consideration. What came out of that was a request for a more detailed report to be presented back to this committee in November, and that will take place. And inclusion of the information.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just briefly, on page 25, we again mentioned the circumstances around the potential for data loss protection. I think we would appreciate, with all the changes that are going on, the difficulties created for some of us, with the time it's taken for our computers and our council computers to buffer and actually access our emails, etc. We do want an update, I believe, on data protection and what the impact is on us all, because certainly to me it's getting a bit worrying this time it's taken to access and the security that we have to go through to get hold of basic emails. So I'm asking specifically, Chair, if we could have an update on data protection in general and where we're about to get inside. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, well, I think that's a reasonable request, and perhaps we could ask somebody from IT to come in and give us an update on it.
It's just something one small item, just to apologise to our committee team that I won't be able to, I know we won't be able to make that date in advance, and so tensions meeting just like that. So apologise. Because I missed the last one as well, it's getting me, so sorry.
I'll do the gun to make sure that you go with very smart.
But that's appreciated, thank you.
Yeah. If I may on the matter of training, it is something that we've all asked for.
Yeah,
I've expressed some considerable enthusiasm for it. there was some disappointment in the number of us who did turn up for the training. Nevertheless, it was good.
Yes.
I've now been twice, and it's so good that I think I'll go even if it's only as a fly on the wall for the third one as well. And the person who's doing the training, it's Elizabeth Humphries, and she's going to go. And she really is absolutely first class because she has the capacity to explain and make you understand. So I think we're on to four now, aren't we? I'm not sure whether Gareth Morton actually said anything on this. At the moment, we've got a report before us, and we really ask to be noted. Do you guys want to actually say something about it, or not?
A couple of members, just a bit of indulgence. With the next couple of items on the agenda, items 4 or 5, both the latest statements of accounts for 2016-17. The first item refers to the pension fund, which the council through the ministry of voting. So once that report and the other final report have been to the pensions committee, considered by the pensions committee, and the inclusion of the final bill of the final report, and it will be approved the accounts. It comes here for final signing. As I say, we are the administrator of voting. But on there, you can see there's a minute and the reference to the Pensions Committee on the 17th of July. And then there's the policy on the findings report. That's what I propose for Grant Falls to do now. You can take it in stages. We agree the pension fund accounts first. And then the item 5 on the agenda is the full statement of accounts, which you can addendum on the back of the native page document. I won't take you through every page of it, but I'll take you through the headline. Pass over to colleagues from Grant Thornton, who will say anything about the other department.
So, thank you, Chair. So, are we dealing with the main accounts now, or the pension fund? Yeah. So, obviously, so,
From our perspective, the audit pension fund is completed, happy report, no particular issues, so there's nothing particular we want to go out today, Chair.
Okay, thanks. That was my reason for hesitation. It seems to me you said it's all fine. So we move on. Okay, then, are you all happy with that?
On that one then, so we do actually have Donna with us tonight, Donna Smith, who's the group of accountants, pensions, and it is mentioned that a thank you to her personally for all the work that her and her team put into, you know, getting the accounts and all this information ready. And so since she's here personally, it'd be nice as a committee to thank her.
Well, I'd certainly go along with that. And I think, Donna, you might possibly want to say a few words on item 4C or not. No, you're quite happy for this, just giving this review. I'll certainly endorse all the comments on that. So, item 4C now, that is also open for voting. Are you happy with it?
Great.
Mr. Chair, on the recommendation of Davis, asking that to Donna, just point out that the transfer of the Pensions Committee were completed by the 31st of May, with a significant bringing forward for 2 years. The order to attention to leave alive. Congratulations, well deserved, I think. I also specifically back with no issues to raise, but what does come out of that is the lack of representation, which has to be signed by myself and the chair of this committee. So if members are happy with that, myself and the chair will sign up.
And then that would be the wording of the committee. We're now coming to 5A, and we probably might want to say something on this one.
Sorry, Chair, can I just mention on the pension? I mean, it is a fabulous report.
Yes.
The situation we find ourselves in now with Merseyside Pension Fund, we are effectively 100% funded, you know, and we've grown 24% annually. I mean, the fund is in a tremendously strong position, and a lot of it is due to the work of the officers and those are involved in. So, we're very fortunate that, you know, as a public sector pension fund to be where we are, so just didn't want that to pass without. You couldn't share the fund as well, is it?
It would be an example of something that you're practically brand leaders in.
Yes, we are, yes. Yeah. And it's because of the office.
Possibly, absolutely. How nice to be able to say so many nice things. We're now going on to item, I think as far as 5B now, I'm going to talk to you from here.
It's like 5A is the next item. Grant Forms and Football Finance Report on the Tractions of Tractions.
Please, sorry, I'm saying, did you want to say anything?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Evening everybody, it's a Robin Baker from Grant Forms, and we are the Council's external auditors. I'm pleased to present our audit finance report for this year. It's obviously quite a detailed report, but I'll just do three things if I may share. One is just very quickly remind you why we bring this report to you, what purpose it serves. Then after you have, I think, other key findings set out in the report, and then I will just be clear about what I'm asking the committee to do this evening, and just be very clear about sort of what happens next in the process, if you want. So just then, in terms of the purpose of this report, so we're required to bring a report to you that sets out the findings and conclusions from our audit of the Council before we conclude our audit, before you take a formal decision, which I think is probably 5B, to adopt and approve the statement of accounts for 16-17. In terms of the sort of key findings that are set out in the report, so I'll start off with our opinion. I'll work on the financial statements that are before you in a minute. So we've not changed, or not had to change, the planned approach that we set out in our audit plan, which we brought to this meeting in May. We've set what we call materiality at £13.8 million. That doesn't mean you go below £13.8 million, but that is a sort of a gauge of, you know, we'd only be interested in areas of uncertainty if they were in excess of that assessment of materiality. There is obviously lots of detailed work that we do with your officers to get to this stage. But we have, and I can assure you, we have addressed all the risks set out in that audit plan. Just two areas that I would just pick out for your particular attention. So we spent quite a bit of time looking at the valuation of possible property, plants and equipment. So places like the building that we're in today, the other operational assets. The overall value of those on your balance sheet is around £637 million. They are valued by in-house valuers. We look at the basis on which they do their work, the understanding of the assets, the assumptions and the judgments they make in terms of valuing that.
And we look at the sort of programme evaluations we run over a period of time. So happy to report that that process works well, and we're happy that there aren't any material errors or uncertainties in the method for getting to that number. The other really big number in your accounts, as I mentioned already, is the liability, the overall liability that you face in terms of pensions going forward for your own employees within the council. So in terms of our work on that, we take comfort from the work of the actuary, look at what the actuary's done, happy that they've made the right sort of estimates and judgments. And we also get assurance from our colleagues who actually audit the pension fund itself as well in terms of the overall value of the assets within the fund. So again, happy to report that that works completely without any undue findings. We've also carefully considered the judgment that you don't produce any group accounts. There are a couple of companies that you're involved with, but we're happy with the officer's assessment that doesn't mean that you produce group accounts. So again, comfortable with that. There are a couple of non-material amendments that we agreed with officers, which have now been made. But no significant issues that I wanted to draw to your attention. The accounts were produced to a good standard. I think we've had really good cooperation with officers in terms of completing the audit this year. I think that's probably gone more smoothly than it has in the past. So, subject to committee being prepared to approve the accounts and approve the letter of representation to us, our intention would be to issue an unqualified audit opinion on those financial statements. Confirm they present a true and fair view of the council's financial position as at the 31st of March this year. So that's the opinion on the accounts. There are a couple of other elements of our audit as well, which I'll just briefly take you through. We're also required to look at and review the annual governance statement, which is published alongside the financial statements. What we're required to do is to say, is it consistent with our knowledge of US normalisation, and is it produced in accordance with the guidance? So happy to confirm it. It does reflect our understanding of the organisation, it is produced in accordance with the guidance. And we note in particular that it does include an action plan, a high-level action plan, for those areas where you believe that controls can and should still be tightened. And obviously that includes responding to the Ofsted inspection from last year and other key areas, including dealing with absence management, that's already noted earlier in the meeting. The final element, just in terms of key findings, onto the campus was value for money. So members, I think, will be aware that we're also required to form a judgment each year as to whether or not the council's got appropriate arrangements in place to secure value for money in the use of resources. There were two key areas that we looked at as part of that work this year. So one is in response to the Ofsted report from last year. You've produced an action plan looking to address the issues that were highlighted in that report. It's clear from the work that we've done around that, which is looking involved in talking to officers and reading it, updated and updated reports on Ofsted, that you have made progress in terms of responding to that. But as you would probably expect at this stage, progress hasn't been able to be actually demonstrable in all areas in terms of certainty as you would expect. And in terms of the other area that's looking at the financial position of the council and the overall medium-term financial planning, our view is the council continues to have appropriate arrangements in place to manage its finances, notwithstanding the tough financial challenges we face going forward. Therefore, our intention would be to, as last year, to issue what we call a qualified except for value for money conclusion, noting that at this stage, you're not in a position to fully demonstrate the improvements in children's services, which you'd actually expect given the time scale since the inspection. So, just in terms of the third thing I said I'd do, which was just to be clear about what I'm asking you to do tonight and what happens next. So I'm asking you to note that the audit of the council for 16-17 is now complete. We have all the answers and cooperation we need to do that. The intention is to issue an unqualified opinion on the council's financial statements, a clean opinion on the annual governance statement that reflects our understanding and view, and a qualified except for value for money conclusion, which is consistent with what we issued last year. Just like to place on record my thanks for your cooperation with our officers, but also the detailed work that my team have done in terms of getting us here, in terms of the work we've completed. Finally, Chair, I just want to give you a very quick update. Obviously, we've got an outstanding objection to the council's accounts relating to the lender option, borrower option, borrowing that's in place. We have made good progress in terms of dealing with that objection. We're just awaiting for sort of national guidance around legal advice in terms of that. So we hope to be able to conclude that in the very near future. But it remains outstanding at this stage. So hope that's helpful. Just very quickly give you an update and what this report's about, the key findings, and then we'll ask the committee to do something. Thank you.
That is very helpful indeed. May I say that I appreciate, I'm sure all the members will appreciate, the manner in which we've made clear that we've had maximum and proper cooperation from the council, because in the past we have had a suggestion from a member of the public that that was not the case, and I'm delighted to have it so clearly expressed by the attitude. Okay, I think who's first? I think it was.
Just a question. I didn't understand the last thing you said about the objection. Could you explain that, please?
Yeah, happy to. So we received the objection to the accounts, which in broad terms argues that the borrowing was unlawful on the basis of being unreasonable, on the basis of being difficult to make judgments about interest rates in that context. We have done an analysis with information provided as well, we've done an analysis of that, we've taken some initial guidance in terms of that. We're now just awaiting for some sort of coordination at a national level around legal advice around that. At that point, we'll be able to then invite both to the objector and to the council, saying this is our initial findings, and then that will allow us and us to then determine that objection. So it's the work is basically ongoing, but it's nearing conclusion.
Thank you.
Yeah, my point has to relate to the 2015-16 accounts.
Trying to go into the council's HR system, self-serve, if I put the wrong password in three times, blocks me out completely, and then I have to go through a process of going through the HR to get another password, verify all my online personal details to get another password. That system applies to quite a number of systems in the council, so it does effectively lock people out of doing strides and multiple times.
So that's what it is really, isn't it? It's the standard procedure. You put your name in three times, you know. It wasn't quite clear from what was said. Thank you for that explanation.
I think that's probably sufficient explanation.
Yes.
Okay.
So, two things. The transformation programme is described on page 7 and also on page 25. And on page 7, we're told the programme's critical is the word that you write upon. Critical for the start of a new model so we can achieve financial stability. And similarly, on page 25, a lot of emphasis on it being the other council that's operated at sustainable cost. So, in Frank Thornton's work, in the next period, will they be looking at the progress of the transformation programme to see that it is doing what it says on the tin, what it's supposed to do, whether it's proceeding at the right rate? So, I don't fit in with Mr. Lane's risk assessment, but we need to know that I think he's on track. The money that we're pouring into those various elements, the program of different projects that's on stream and live to go through at certain stages, then we know that that's on track. So, is that something that Grant Thornton ordered by way of seeing things are in place that are all lined up like ducks?
Yeah, no, happy to do so. I mean, we would, we would sit down with management to discuss the details of our program of work for next year. But clearly, the transformation program and the progress that's made around that is important in terms of the future viability of the council. Therefore, it's something we would discuss. Now, whether that's detailed work that we would do, or whether it's something maybe covered partly by us and partly by internal audit. Or partly through gaining assurances elsewhere, but certainly it's an important area that we will pick up as part of our planning for next year's update, and we'll then obviously bring that plan to you as a committee to discuss and to follow up as a thing.
Right, declare that I'm a member of the improvement board in children's services, which is covered on page 27, quite a long explanation. Probably quite a fair one about the sense of progress in recent months, and the most recent Ofsted letter was quite encouraging on the areas that it looked at. But in the rather italicised and bold paragraph at the bottom of page 27, it might be I'm reading the wrong thing into it. I want to be sure that whilst I'm perhaps as a member here or a member there monitoring progress, and I'm aware that sums of money have to be put into IT, or sums of money have to be put into recruitment, and retention, and all those issues facing social workers, that there's a criticism here about reliable financial performance information. So maybe I was reading too much into it, perhaps being too sensitive, but I wanted to assure myself that whilst I'm in either here or there, I'm not shelling out shed loads of money without Grant Thornton being careful about monitoring. I'm sure what we're doing is all being monitored in many places, but the implication there was that we weren't doing the right thing.
Okay, Phil, that's a clear question. Robin, this comes from the office reading too much into it.
Yeah. that's a leading question, Chair. I will address the substantive point. That is, the wording that's used in the italicised bold text of it refers to the criteria against which we're required to assess all councils, including yourself. So it's standard wording, it's not trying to make any particular criticism about monitoring financial information in that context. The overall judgment, which I think we're all comfortable with, and I think as Phil recognised, we've tried to capture quite well, I think there is that progress has been made, and I think that there's some really encouraging signs in terms of progress we've made in the assessment that Ofsted have come back with, but at this stage, can we say that the services for children are back to a level that you would want them to be? I think the answer probably is no. Therefore, on that basis, we stick with the qualified except for conclusion that we issued last. actually, and the wording is to some extent driven by the framework that we work with it. So I hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Any comments? Very good. I think in that case we can go on to our next item, which will vote 5A, which I think we've just done. Okay, so on to the next item. Tom, I need your direction. 5B, I think 5C is the same as the addendum to 5B. So do you want to take over from the other?
Right, indeed, Joe. Why the addendum is actually the full statement of the to get one?
Yeah.
Which is what this committee is effectively signing on tonight.
Yeah.
That is the statement that's been published by the MQ, which was prepared by Dave Malign to sign and publish it. It's then subject to all the subject to consideration on the order of finding due course and the change we've implemented in the account service. It includes the annual government statement, it includes the implementation of the accounts. Subject to members being happy with changes at what we will find in the order. The accounts, as appended there, of the accounts that will be published by the end of September. The only item that's missing from there is the order of opinion, which can't be granted until we sign on myself and the chair. Assignment of a letter of death, which we can only sign on when the committee have been happy with the other finds and taking all the actions we could. So that's the progress now. The accounts themselves are the same as published for the first time at the end of June. They were then subject to audit, have the audit finds report in front of you. There have been some minor changes to that, but the financial position of the council remains unchanged from what was reported to the council. There have been some minor amendments to the annual government statement. The committee made some references here in regard to cabinet. Cabinet then also and yourself wanted to learn around the Ofsted comments that they've been leaping up. That's been reflected in the case of the annual government statement. That's cabinet in July time. We'll remind them that what doesn't reflect the performance of the 2016-17 financial year. The comments we just heard about where we are with Ofsted, particularly after the it represents the position until March 17. So in terms of where we are at the moment, well, I'll say if everything goes through, the audit opinion should be issued next couple of days. That would be included in the statement which is appended. And then be published by the few days. It has to be published by the 30th of September. Clearly it intends what we want to publish on Friday the 29th, if not before it's suggested the opinion coming in. In terms of where we are in that, my inquiries from Donna and the work of the pensions team. I could not do this with my team without the work of James Smith because it's a tremendous job you need to do for what is a substantial document to go. And also then work with our colleagues in Grant Thornton to produce the annual defines report and give us the multitude of queries that come out with our team. So I think it's a thorough piece of work that's been done by both parties. I say without getting this would not be possible. So where we are with the statement now, well, we ask if members are happy myself and the chair to sign the order of finance report is appended. The letter of representation is appended. It's basic. This requires the auditors before the immediate opinion. The accounts are detailed in the addendum. I don't propose to take you through them. But the bits have been those across the narrative report before them. I think in the past we've gone through with members. They're 180 pages, a lot of information to do with the accounts. Simpler and many bodies since the state, we not make the accounts simpler, more understandable. One drive towards that thing is the narrative and the thoughts of the report. Those who follow the fact intend to say it. We make it simplified in terms of the accounting supply. The report has got greater now to explain now where the accounts, the structure of the accounts, and how the council is managed, and also the accounting information. In a way that those pages of the introduction of the accounts tries to simplify. That's the technical data that follows. Happy to send members to the accounts, but I think it's also providing information in there. Happy to say anything about
it. Yes, Christina.
Yeah, Tom, it's just clarification. On page 87, item 19, the debtors, against on the main paperwork, 86 of Grant Thornton's. On the miscalculation, how do those two tie in? Are they different years or what does it mean?
Misclassification of debtors is basically the answer to one line. They took that particular line.
Yeah, but that was 1.5 million and 0.5 million, and then we've got different amount of debtors on page 87. Does it mean the short-term ones are ones that you pay, get paid quickly, and these ones that historically haven't been paid? I'm not quite sure what it both look like, figures are different, what it means.
Is this the item on page 86 on the 2 million?
Page 86, miscalculation, and then on 5C, page 87, 19, it's got battered. And then, as I'm reading through it all, I'm getting confused with that one.
Todd, I'd like to help, Councillor. Our audit findings report references are tested on the classification of debt. So note 19 has got five or six types of classification of the debts that need to be categorised as. In our work on the constituent elements of that, we found one or two instances where amounts already within those higher amounts were misclassified. So the amounts we reference don't appear on that note, rather than the constituent elements of the 17 million and the 11. You wouldn't see 1.5 or 0.5, but if I've understood your query correctly, rather they've been changed from one line to another, so they wouldn't appear as those amounts.
So 6076, the 11475, are within here. That's the other local authorities and NHS bodies.
Yeah, the changes would be between the lines. If you'd seen the original set of accounts, you probably wouldn't track the differences.
I understand what you mean about on the wrong lines, but I don't understand why the amounts are so different.
In terms of the statements of accounts of the appendix, that includes all the other debtors, all the NHS bodies. Within that, the price of number of disabilities for one category is actually misclassified. Not all of it, just one element of it.
I think you all might be looking at different pages. Can you see what the trustees have got?
It's on this supplementary papers.
Page 87.
Section 19.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's box 19.
What's the... And the other one, why are they all different figures?
Well, in terms of section 19, the debtors, they are the total debtors of the council. But then look at picking the NHS one, and the line there says £11 million over the deficit of March 17.
Yeah.
When the report initially went to audit, that figure would be incorrectly stated. The auditors found out that one item within there should have been on a different line.
Yeah, so if you take out the 0.5 million, where does the 1.5 million? Does the NHS bodies just keep owing us loads and loads of money?
In terms of the debtors, they are people that owe us money. In terms of the misclassification, it's just included within the wrong elements, the different elements of the money.
Yeah, so if you take out the 0.5 million of the NHS and put it into the local authorities, they've still got the same amount. How much do they actually owe us?
So the amount they owe is not in doubt. It's just the way it's been classified. So there's a range of debtors. So an entity owes you 1.5 million or 0.5 million. The way the account requires you to express it was incorrect. The validity of the debt is not in doubt, it remains probably paid by now.
So it's just that 2 million. It's
been moved from one line to another.
Yes, I know that. But that 2 million is just within the 6 million. Is that what you're saying?
It's within the overall debt balance. That explains it. It's a valid debt.
So it wasn't all of the NHS bodies.
No,
it was just certain items of NHS.
Yeah, so there might be
that's
the
right.
Yeah.
Is that okay,